From the storytellers at E60, this is E60 Pictures.
You gotta go poo-poo? Oh, we'll wait a few minutes. Wait till Mommy finishes. Dear Morgana, first let me start to say it's a real honor to be writing you. Like any kid, I grew up wanting to be a baseball player, but I also wanted to be a superstar so I could get a kiss from the famous Morgana. Isn't that sweet? Gosh, people are so nice.
Smoke, look who's here. Morgana's here at the ballpark.
There are a lot of ways to become famous in America. 45 years ago, a woman named Morgana found one of them.
She was a rather large, busty woman that made a habit of going around and running out on the baseball field and choosing a player and going out there and giving him a hug and a kiss.
Morgana's here at the ballpark, and she's going to start off the year with a kiss on the side of the cheek for Steve Yeager.
Well, I think she was a celebrity. You know, she was the original. Anybody else is a copy.
And she carries herself in a way. There's an excitement. It's an attack. It's gonna happen quick. It's, you better watch, all right? Because she's in and out. She's the kissing bandit. If you say you don't remember her, it's because you have never seen her. Because if you see her once, you will know her for the rest of your life.
Here we go again. Is that the kissing bandit? That's Morgana. With all the security in this ballpark, she somehow got through. Enjoying it.
At the height of her infamy in the 1980s, every big name in sports was a potential target. Every game a potential crime scene for Morgana, the kissing bandit.
I don't know who she is. Her name is Morgana. She went out, she planted a kiss on Fred Lynn.
I heard all those people yelling, and I knew it couldn't be for me. I thought, number one, it was either earthquake or those beach balls on the field. And it was beach balls on the field.
Well, all I can say is I've kissed 15 baseball players. Hopefully tonight will be my 16th. I'm going to do it for the Texas fans here.
Oh, boy.
Maybe I'll get you later, too.
One year, as I recall, Nolan Ryan pitched opening day. And Morgana was billed that she was going to show up. And I think they drew 40,000. The next year, when she didn't show up, they drew 20,000.
What if you saw her coming? Would you take off or would you wait?
No, I'd have to wait because I don't want a good close look.
Now, the Astros know the kissing bandit is in here somewhere, but they don't know when she'll strike or who she's after. They have but one clue. She doesn't like men who chew tobacco. The suspense didn't last long. With no score in the top of the first, Morgana made her move. The main target, pitcher Nolan Ryan.
Nolan Ryan, George Brett. She was getting the big boys, so I kind of took it like, oh, man, I kind of made it a little bit.
And look who was at the game. Morgana made a cameo. She got Mattingly and then praise for clemency from New York's finest.
I think players got jealous of other players who got kissed.
I know one of your favorite people in the NBA is Utah coach Frank Layden, and you're not alone.
I don't remember who we played that night. I don't remember whether we won or lost, but I do remember that moment. Everything else was kind of foggy.
When the heavily endowed Morgana Roberts spots her prey, few, if any, turn their cheek. Certainly not the entertaining coach of the Utah Jazz. In fact, as you saw, he got kissed on both sides. The kissing bandit strikes again.
It immortalized me. You know, they'll be showing that years from now.
She was probably happy that he was alive.
And it was just like a stolen moment, a stolen kiss. And yet, I remember that. I remember looking at her and saying,
this is one beautiful lady.
Morgana was everywhere, popping up 4 times in Playboy magazine, and even a Hollywood cult classic.
I'm Morgana, the kissing band. All your fans sent me to give you a kiss.
Go ahead, Morgana. So Jake...
She would probably be more famous today. You got all the reality shows now, and she would be on all of the talk shows, and there are, you know, 300 cable networks, and she might be hosting a show, really.
Hi, sports fans. I'm Morgana, the kissing bandit.
Morgana became as famous as the men she kissed. Over 30 years, she earned a unique kind of fame by doing this very specific and strange thing over and over again. Then one day, she just stopped. It didn't make sense. What made her run toward the spotlight? And what made her run away?
I don't know why she stopped. Yeah, I think there suddenly was a void.
She's kind of gotten lost with the rest of us back in that era.
That's the kissing bandit, Morgana.
Since she disappeared, Morgana hasn't wanted to answer those questions. Not from neighbors, or her new friends, or the reporters who tracked her down.
I think the fascination with Morgana now, where's Morgana? Is, am I dead? Am I alive? Do I weigh 600 pounds? Do I have my teeth? This will put an end, because after this interview, that's it. I quit. No, you can fill in the word that rhymes.
Now, in her first interview since 1999, the story of an odd and public American life from the lips of the woman who lived it. Morgana the Kissing Bandit, a journey that began at a Major League Baseball game in the summer of 69.
R.C. Buford, Greg Popovich, Alvin Gentry are the assistants, and John Anderson is the trainer. And what is this? That's the kissing bandit, Morgana.
The spectacle lasted for nearly 3 decades. Everyone with a pulse in the 70s and 80s caught a glimpse of the kissing bandit.
Here comes Morgana.
But few actually knew Morgana. And she has never publicly told the story of her rise and sudden retreat.
I think the fascination with Morgana now, where's Morgana? Is, am I dead? Am I alive? Do I weigh 600 pounds? Do I have my teeth? This will put an end, because after this interview, that's it. I quit. No, you can fill in the word that rhymes.
So how many people in all do you think you kissed?
Oh, gosh, I have no idea.
Well, help me ballpark it.
60, 70, I'd say, because I know when we were doing a list, we hit on around 40. I know it was a long list. I don't know if I actually sit there and counted, but I think I started counting. Then I got bored and fell asleep.
Morgana says the kiss that started it all was 45 years ago. It was 1969. There was Woodstock and the first man on the moon. A time when anything was possible, including for a teenager at a Cincinnati Reds game with some friends, just waiting to be seen.
So all the ballplayers, they were all like whistling at us, or, you know, from the dugout, or spitting their tobacco at us, which is really a compliment. So Pete Rose, he wasn't paying any attention to us. I don't even remember which one of them said to you, I'll bet you $5 you won't run out and give him a kiss.
And I remember I was playing center field, I'm running out to my position at Crosley Field, and I could just feel somebody running behind me. I mean, I was scared. I was scared to death. What is this girl chasing me for? What did I do?
I ran out, gave him a kiss, and he said, "You crazy blank and broad? Are you out of your blank and mind?" Except he didn't use the word blank.
I said, "You're going to get in trouble." She says, "I sure in the hell hope so."
And then I went back to my seat. Nobody cared.
You mean you went back to your seat?
I went back, climbed over the fence, and sat down, and we watched the rest of the game.
A Cincinnati sports writer dubbed her the kissing bandit. 3 more kisses followed.
It started to feel like almost like an addiction. You know what I mean? I'd get like a buzz, you know, everybody cheering and hollering and everything.
It was what she'd been looking for her whole life. A life that began in Louisville, Kentucky, where Morgana's parents agreed their lives would be better if she'd never existed at all.
My father, you know, didn't want me. And this is so silly. My mother drank spirited turpentine, my grandmother said, and I'm not even sure what spirited turpentine is, but she thought she could abort me, but instead I was just born with bad kidneys and a few other little minor health issues. It's about 4 or 5 years old. And I remember my mother coming up to my grandmother's one time. I was standing in the hall and I peeked around to look at her, and I don't know what their conversation was, but I remember my mother looked over at me and pointed at me and said, "I hate her," talking about me.
Her grandmother sent her away to a boarding school run by nuns. She was 10 years old, with no mother or father in her life. She was on her own in the world.
I'd pray at night. I said, "Jesus, if you really love me, let me die so I can be with you soon." So that was probably kind of a low period, but I knew that there was somebody up there that cared about me. It kept me going. I just wanted to go with them. You know what I mean?
It just seems like that's a way of saying it. I don't like my life. I don't...
Kind of like I've given up. I got to this point, but I don't think I can hold it together any longer, type of thing.
2 years later, Morgana packed up the few things she could call her own, and she ran away. She imagined a new and better life. Instead, she washed up on the streets of Baltimore, homeless and alone.
It was just dark and cars kept coming up and men would stop and yell out, "Do you need a ride?" and stuff. It was really scary. I can remember I was hungry and I thought, "Where do you eat?" You know, and I had no money. I had no money. So I would look in the cans to find food. And a lot of times people throw away fruits. It's just getting a little bit soft, bread that's only got a little bit of green mold on it. So that's how I ate for quite a while. It's scary out there on the street, sleeping in doorways and eating out of garbage cans, let me tell you.
At 13 years of age, Morgana couldn't find a job until a strip club named the Flamingo looked the other way.
Do you think the Flamingo Club was the first time that you felt like people liked you?
Yes, yes. As far as acceptance, I'm attractive, I'm fun, I'm a good person, they like me, I look good in this outfit, and I'm giving it the best show I can do. And they get it.
Morgana found a way to feel good about herself. She had a paycheck. She was off the streets. She got out of Baltimore, and it was that person, the abandoned, runaway, former homeless teenage stripper, who a year after she kissed Pete Rose, returned to Cincinnati with an even bigger plan. She told reporters she was going to kiss Johnny Bench at the 1970 All-Star Game.
Well, I didn't know it was going to be in the paper. And they said, "She's not going to get on the field." Well, then that was a challenge. Nobody's going to tell me I can't do that. I can get on that field. What do you mean security's going to stop me? So I put on a disguise. I jumped that fence. Next thing I know, I'm on the ground. I saw a man kicking me before I went unconscious. The guy had cracked my tailbone, cracked two ribs. I thought, they're killing me. This man, who put his hand up under my shirt, tore the flesh off. He was the one that did the kicking in the tailbone and all. All the players were out of the dugout screaming, "Leave her alone." See, I couldn't hear any of that. I was just thinking, am I alive?
Morgana decided the underbelly of America was safer. And for 7 years, she stayed away from ballparks and moved from coast to coast, stage to stage.
She was one of the best-known strippers in America. And I remember it'd be like Elvis, when she finished her act, they would rush her from the stage right out the back door into her car, and literally, Morgana has left the building.
But she missed the attention and rush she got from kissing ballplayers in front of packed stadiums. So in 1977, the kissing bandit returned. One of her first victims was George Brett, who had an idea of his own.
We got rained out a couple nights later. And I knew she was in town. I don't remember the name of the place where she was performing.
What was the name of that theater? Chelsea Theater.
The Chelsea Theater. And so I went in there and I talked to the guy, told him who I was, and I said, I want to run up on stage and get her.
He came and jumped up on stage and grabbed my hat, put it on his head, grabbed my feather boa.
And we laughed and giggled and just had a great time. I said, now we're even.
Here is George Brett.
2 years later, in 1979, they would meet again.
That, my friends, I guess is the kissing panda, Morgana.
Then Morgana took her act beyond baseball. They were race car drivers and jockeys. For her entire life, Morgana had been searching for something, and finally, she had found it.
When the crowd loves you, when you come out from that ovation, that's better than food, money, sex, drugs, I don't care what it is. That's it. That's acceptance.
Did you feel beautiful when you were being cheered?
No, I never felt beautiful. I felt funny. You know what I mean? Like I said, I may have looked like a sex symbol to people, but I've always been a comedian at heart.
I'm at a hockey game in front of a sold-out crowd for the Fort Wayne Comets of the International Hockey League. 10,000 people are in the stands, and behind me, I hear a big commotion on the ice.
How do you kiss a chicken?
Carefully.
I think Morgana helped influence me by thinking outside the box.
Well, now the answer to the riddle, when is a kiss a crime? When the puckering interrupts the pitching at Memorial Stadium is the answer.
It looks like Morgana has made her way onto the field.
How can you tell?
She's got to be looking for Cal. How do you face the league's second best ERA after that?
So what'd they do in jail?
Oh, they just lock you up. One of the prostitutes said to me when they brought me in, they said, what are you in for? And I said, I kissed Cal Ripken Jr. She said, my God, where'd you kiss him?
I had no intent to commit a crime, and if Cal Ripken hadn't wanted me to, he wouldn't have leaned down for me to kiss him on the cheek.
How many arrests, how many convictions?
No convictions. A reporter told me 19 arrests. They always would arrest me for trespassing or causing a turmoil. But if you have a good attorney, they understand you and they explain your situation, and then you can win. So we went to court and we pleaded the gravity defense.
She leans over the fence, the law of gravity being the operative at all times. She's compelled to leave where she is and go over the rail and down to the field.
How much did it cost you an attorney's
fees? Oh my gosh, up to a point, I'd probably save $40,000, $50,000.
By the mid-80s, Morgana was earning six figures as an exotic dancer, and the kissing bandit was everywhere.
At the height of the mania, like, how big was it?
I don't know. I guess sometimes when the media would meet me at the airport or something, they'd see I'm coming into town for an appearance, and I'd think, well, who's on the plane with me? And I'd be shocked they'd come up to me, you know?
Ladies and gentlemen, Morgana, the kissing bandit. Yes.
You know, in any business, you kind of admire longevity. I mean, it was a silly kind of fame, and yet she stretched it out for a long time.
But as the 90s approached, the stage lights started to dim. Morgana neared 40, and she seemed like a fading piece of nostalgia.
Michael Cooper in the backcourt. Oh, look at this, coming out to midcourt. This is that kissing lady. What's her name?
Morgana.
Morgana, to kiss Kareem. Well, forget Morgana. Here's the rocket starters. Otis Thorpe and Purvis Short. Hakeem Olajuwon, Eric Floyd.
So when was the last time you ran on a field or a court and kissed someone?
Scottie Pippen, that would be early 90s.
Did you know beforehand it was going to be the last one?
No, I didn't. I kind of just took it, but then I started to be invited to do things and get paid for it. That's not bad.
Back at Memorial Stadium in Boise, Idaho, where the Eugene Emeralds and Boise Hawks are getting ready to face off and getting ready to face the bungee cord is Morgana the Kissing Bandit out in right field.
How you feeling?
Excited.
Ready to jump?
Ready to throw up for him.
She says she's either going to be a permanent part of home plate or there'll be two new pitching mounds in this stadium.
What was it that kept you doing this?
I don't know. It was just fun. It was a sad thing. I was starting to be accepted by minor league teams. Ballparks would advertise I was going to be there, and they said I sold more seats. They keep bringing me back.
Three, two, one.
Oh, my goodness.
this?
Whoa! You'll never see Morgana like that again.
She's probably coming at the end of the line as a, quote, performer. It's probably why baseball players stop playing baseball. She kind of goes over the hill at some point.
All right, folks, it's official. Dan's 2,000th show.
She entered the meta realm of the 80s has-beens, spoofing herself in commercials, reprising her own glory days in the cult classic film Kingpin in 1996.
Oh, give us a break.
Her last real 15 minutes of fame. And then, as suddenly as the kissing bandit had appeared, she vanished.
Why was it time for it to end?
It began in 1969 when a 17-year-old stripper accepted a dare. 3 decades later, Morgana the Kissing Bandit had become a pop culture institution.
Here came 1999, and my agent called me and he said, do you want to start for the next season? I'd already told him I was thinking about quitting, and I said, nope, I'm sticking to this.
Why was it time for it to end?
Because I was tired. I was tired. I just wanted to see what a life was like where I could go to lunch with my girlfriends, where I can get up every morning and go to my gym.
Was it hard to quit?
No. It wasn't hard to quit, no.
Morgana settled into a quiet suburban life near Columbus, Ohio, with her husband Bill, an accountant. They've been married for 31 years. Bill didn't want to appear on camera.
What made you fall in love with Bill?
I think, first of all, he's shy, where I'm talkative, you might have noticed. We have so many things in common, just the way we feel about life in general. And I hope I'm as good a person as he is, because he is such a good person.
The woman who once soaked in the attention of thousands of strangers now finds comfort with just a handful of close friends.
I think a lot of people know who she is, but she doesn't promote herself. And I mean, once in a while, and it's usually a man, we like whisper to, are you Morgana? And she'll say, no, my name's Mo.
Been best friends for over 20 years. So one thing she said, you know what? We're family, Tim. You and I are family. But we're the best kind of family because we were able to choose each other. I don't see any of the Morgana the Kissing Bandit.
But before Morgana could fully become Mo, there was one last thing she needed to do, one last piece of her past that she needed to let go of. Morgana decided to have a breast reduction.
Why should I have to go through life wearing big, baggy clothes just to blend in? I'm just Mo. So that's when I decided, and it was scary, because I'd always said, I'm not going to do it. Why should I amputate part of my body? But I am so thrilled. It's the best thing I ever did for myself. It's really the best thing.
She's a trivia answer, a fading memory from the past, a homeless teen, a piece of Americana, a thief of other people's fame. She's also a survivor who earned her anonymous life and the long-sought peace that comes with it.
At one point in your life, no one believed you could make it, and then anytime you went in public, 60,000 people told you you could. Mm-hmm.
From I hate her, when I got out of the hospital having my kidney removed from my mother, I hate her pointing at me. Going from that to people saying, you can make it. You've made it through that, girl. You can make it to home plate. You can make it. You know what I mean? And I made it.
And probably, down deep somewhere, she's saying, what's Frank doing right now?
Are they real?
No. The real ones are in the safety deposit box. Ah!
Size of your head. I can show you. Kind of bra. Kind of goes good with my shirt.
I don't think Ray Charles would have missed it.